next catastrophic event that could be coming our way? A lot of people ask themselves that. Wow, is that going to be hurricanes? Could it be earthquakes? Could it be volcanoes? No, folks. The next cataclysmic event that is coming our way could be the mega drought, and it's knocking on our doors. Welcome to Survival Preparedness for Beginners, and I'm here to bring you some information that you're probably not going to find on your mainstream cable channel. You're not going to find it out there. They just don't want you to know about some of this kind of stuff, all right? Until it's a little too late. And that's why it is so important for you to be prepping now for what may be coming down the pike. Now you ask yourself exactly what is a mega drought, and I'm going to cover that in this video. We're also going to cover what is seeding clouds. Now I'm not talking about they're throwing seeds up in the air. We're talking about they're using certain types of particles and stuff that they put up into the atmosphere, into the clouds, to help generate snow in the higher elevations so they can get the snow to fall to the ground. We're going to be covering that also. And we're also going to cover what is the outcome of a mega drought and what does it mean for you and me in the end. So stay tuned, because we're going to start getting into some of this stuff, and we're going to start covering that right now on Survival Preparedness for Beginners. The next major catastrophic event that could be taking place here in the near future is the making of the mega drought. The western U.S. is in the midst of yet another dangerous dry spell, as we all know. The drought has been building over the past years, and since November, a greater stretch of the West has been in the most severe category of drought than any time in the 20 years that the National Drought Mitigation Center has been keeping records. The western states are already facing shortages, and with the National Weather Service projecting that the dry stretch will continue, the problems that accompany droughts are likely to pile up heading into this summer. Researchers from Columbia's Earth Institute studied ice samples, seabeds, and tree rings in order to identify three reasons why they think that this could happen. Number one, cooling water temperatures in the Pacific Ocean. Number two, warming waters in the Atlantic Ocean. And number three, something called radioactive forcing, which I'll be covering more of in just a minute. According to the scientists, mega droughts happened during the medieval times in the southwest United States between the 9th and the 16th century. They lasted for many years, as we can see. Now, they believe, the scientists, that global warming could cause them to happen again, but on a much greater scale. If you're asking yourself, what is a mega drought? A mega drought is a drought which happens on an extreme scale and for much longer than a drought would usually last. We're talking up to 2 decades, folks. A drought happens when there is not enough rain for a long period of time. This causes the land to dry out and a shortage of water, which can have a knock-on impacts, such as reduction in how many crops can be produced, and problems for people and animals who rely on water to drink. During a drought, farmers in affected areas can be unable to grow their crops or feed and give water to their animals, just like back in the Great Depression and the Great Dust Bowl. This can have an impact on their livelihood and on our livelihood, as people are unable to earn a living and make money from the land as they usually would. And it's going to make it difficult for us to be able to buy goods at a reasonable price if we can get the goods at the stores. What causes this mega drought, you may ask yourself? Radioactive forcing, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, was found to be one of the causes of mega droughts. It can be a positive or negative, and a positive radioactive forcing happens when the Earth's atmosphere traps more energy from the sun. The more of this energy that is trapped in the atmosphere, the higher the water evaporation rate is, meaning more water is sucked out of the soil, making it very dry, which means you can't grow anything, and grass and stuff doesn't grow, so you have nothing to feed your livestock. Burning fossil fuels and having increased levels of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere can trap more energy from the sun, increasing the radioactive forcing. Now, one of the other biggest issues and causes of a mega drought is La Niña, a weather phenomenon that cools the temperatures of the water in the Pacific Ocean. La Niña happens around every 2 to 7 years, basically, alternating with another weather event called El Niño. La Niña can push very wet weather storms to certain areas, causing severe flooding, but leaving other areas without rain for very long periods of time, causing severe droughts. Climate scientists have noticed that La Niña events have happened more frequently in the last years and the last decades than any other time in history. So this fact, combined with the increase in the Earth's temperature due to more of the sun's energy being trapped, is leading the scientists to think that we could be headed for more mega droughts in the near future. Now we're going to talk about seed clouding. Open flames burst from the throats of metal chimneys mounted on squat towers nestled among the peaks of the mountains. With a low hiss, puffs of particles belch from their mouths into the air, which the wind catches them and whisks them away. These aren't ordinary particles. They are tiny bits of crushed up silver iodide, a crystal-like photosynthesis substance once used in photography. But it's not used to take pictures out there in the mountains. It's meant to make snow, folks. As the wind whips the particles across the mountaintops, drafts of air sweep them higher into the sky. And inside the clouds, they like to attract each other. The water droplets begin to cluster around the particles, freezing solid as they gather together. These frozen clusters eventually grow too heavy to stay in the air. They fall from the cloud and drift gently towards the earth, dusting the mountaintops with fresh snow. This is not a page from a science fiction novel. Cloud seeding is a real practice. In fact, it's been around for decades. It's used today to boost participation in at least 8 states across the western U.S. and dozens of countries around the world also use this too. Now let's give you a little bit of history on cloud seeding and where it came from. A gentleman named Vincent Schaefer, a researcher with General Electric, is often credited with the first cloud seeding experiments in the 1940s. Much of Schaefer's work was during and after World War II, centered on preventing aircraft from icing over in midair. So he designed a special homemade freezer to help him better understand the way ice forms inside clouds. As the story goes, Schaefer entered the lab one day to discover that the freezer had been turned off. Hoping to cool it quickly as possible, he placed a block of dry ice inside the box. A cloud of glistening ice crystals instantly formed in the air. In 1946, Schaefer conducted the first true cloud seeding experiment by aircraft. He dropped 6 pounds of crushed dry ice into a cloud in the Adirondack Mountains of New York. Almost immediately, snow began to fall. In later experiments, Schaefer and other GE colleagues would discover that certain types of particles are more effective at helping ice crystals form. Silver iodide, they found, is one of the best. Weather modifications quickly captured the attention of, guess who, the U.S. government. Over the next few decades, it would find cloud seeding experiments on everything from drought management to military applications. The research focused on winter geographic seeding to enhance snowfall in the Rocky Mountains and the Sierra Nevada and precipitation in the coast ranges of Southern California. In the United States, cloud seeding is used to increase rain and or snow in areas experiencing drought, to reduce the size of hailstones that form in thunderstorms, and to reduce the amount of fog in and around airports. In the summer of 1948, the usually humid city of Alexandria, Louisiana, under Mayor Carl B. Close, seeded a cloud with dry ice at the airport during a drought, and it quickly produced 0.85 inches of rainfall at that time. Cloud seeding is occasionally used by major ski resorts to induce snowfall. 11 Western states and one Canadian province, Alberta, have ongoing weather modification operational programs. In January of 2006, an $8.8 million cloud seeding project began in Wyoming to experience the effect of cloud seeding on snowfall over Wyoming's mountain ranges. In Oregon, Hood River seeding was used by Portland General Electric to produce snow for hydropower in 1974 and 1975. The results were substantial, but caused an unburden on locals who experienced overpowering rainfall, causing streets to collapse and mudslides like no one has ever seen. PG&E discontinued its seeding practices the following year because of the devastation to the American people. The U.S. signed the Environmental Modification Convention in 1978, which banned the use of weather modifications for hostile purposes only. And you want to know what the risks are and the side effects of doing this cloud seeding and playing God? Well, here is a few. The risks or concerns like unwanted ecological changes and ozone depletion, continued ocean warming, eradicating changes in rainfall patterns and snow patterns, and rapidly warming the earth are just a few of some of the effects of cloud seeding. We move on to what is the outcome for us. The outcome for us folks is, if this mega drought does kick up and start and lasts for decades, it's going to be putting a very big strain on life as we know it. It's going to change the way that we eat. It's going to change the way that people make money. It's going to hurt all the farmers. It's going to really destroy things as we know it. Now, I don't mean to be the bearer of bad news here, but this is something major that everybody needs to know about and pay attention to. If you do watch the Weather Channel, starting today at 8 a.m. this morning on AMHQ, they're going to be talking about the same exact subject, the mega drought, because as most scientists believe, it is coming. And what takes place is, first thing that's going to get hit will be all our fields, all of our growth, our fall harvest may not be there because nothing grew. Because without the rain, without moisture in the ground, nothing's going to grow. And what happens with the livestock is, when a drought really comes to town, most of the time, if it sticks around for a while, what the farmers end up doing that raise livestock, they'll sell off a lot of their herd at that point in time, because they don't have a way to feed them. They don't have a way to get them water because there is none. So in a short term, the prices of meat will go down because there'll be such an overabundance of it, the prices will be so cheap. But in long term, what happens is you turn around and now you have gone through all the overages that all the stores and everything else may have. And now there's not enough to go around. So now the prices are going to go sky high. Prices of your corn, soybeans, wheat, the whole nine yards are all going to start going up because of a mega drought. So if a mega drought starts to roll into town, you will see the effects come towards the end of this year to the beginning of next year. So what can we do? The number one question you need to ask yourself is, are you prepared for another catastrophic event that could hit our country? I'm not talking about anywhere else in the world. I'm talking about the United States of America. We've been through the pandemic. We're still going through the pandemic. But if something happened that is going to drastically impact our food supply chain, this could not be a very good thing. So what you need to be doing is start prepping now. Start putting away your grains, your rice, your wheat, flour, sugar, whatever you can do. Maybe you need to buy a bigger freezer. And if the price is to start to go down because there is more of an overstock at this point, maybe you should buy more meat and freeze it. I would suggest if that is something you're going to be looking to do, you want to make sure that you buy yourself a vacuum sealer. So this way here, it will make your meat products and your freezer products last a heck of a lot longer than what they will in their regular package or just a normal freezer bag you'd buy from the store, because air is the biggest destroyer of our food. You need to start stocking up, and you need to do it now, because there's just too many things that could really put a hindrance on this. For one, we're coming into hurricane season. It's just around the corner, folks. Another thing is, what about all the floods and everything else that probably will be coming here soon also? All this all affects everything. If farmers' fields are flooded because of snow melt in the north and the rivers overflow their banks, it puts another strain on our whole system. The key to this whole video is you can be prepared for this. You can be ready in case there is the making of a mega drought on the horizon. And from what I've seen and what I've been reading and I've been doing my homework on, I would urge everyone out there on my channel, and even if you're not on my channel, to start preparing now for what's going to be knocking on our door later. I can only hope that everybody out there learned a little something today about what the next cataclysmic event could be in this country and about what is coming down the pike. It's already started. It's already going on. It's only a matter of time before it gets even worse, just like it did way back around the 16th century, between the 9th and the 16th century, as I did talk about. You know, these are just things that are taking place. And the sad part of it is the government really doesn't want to step in on all these big corporations that really don't want to or care about what the climate really is, as long as they are making money.
It's all about money, folks. Okay? It's all about who fills whose pockets. And we're the ones that are paying for it. We're the ones that are going to pay the higher prices. We're the ones that are going to have the lack of products. We're the ones that are going to be punished in the end because of what these people are doing. Now, maybe a lot of people out there don't agree. Well, that's so be it. That's your choice. But what I'm saying here is, if you look at the evidence and you look what's going on now that has gone on in history, as I have said before, history repeats itself. And when it comes back around, it really likes to kick us right in the ass, period. Unfortunately, those type of things keep happening. We have control over it, but we can only do so much as people. Yes, you can try doing your recycling, you can try doing this, buy an electric car, whatever it is you think that you can do. But in the end, if the big corporations aren't the ones that are really putting forth the effort to try to change what is going on, these type of things and scenarios are only going to get worse as time goes by. So thank you for watching this video today. I'm Survival Preparedness for Beginners. If you did enjoy this video, do me a favor. Give me a thumbs up. Hit that subscribe button. Click that little bell. And until next time, I will catch all of you on the dry side.